It is my delight, and I hope we can use the time well today, and I'm happy to field some questions at the very end. First of all, make sure I can work the technology, and I'm going to advance to the next slide and show you a little bit about the Lanier Theological Library. I've been working here now for a little over a year. I'm the senior research fellow there, and I would be amiss if I didn't bring you greetings in South Africa at the seminary there from Mark Lanier, who is our founder, who is a great scholar in his own right. He's an author of a number of books. I'm helping him with some others. And you can see a little bit of our library there, photo to your left, which is part of our great hall. We're a research library located in Northwest Houston. If you were to see us, you would say a little piece of Oxford has broken off and fallen in Northwest Houston. It's a beautiful place. It's my honor to work there. And over on the right is our stone chapel. It's a replica of a 6th century AD, a Byzantine church that was found in a part of Turkey. And it has since been by Gertrude Bell. It has since been sort of leveled and made into a parking lot or a mall or something like that. But it was a wonderful chapel. We've recreated it. We have lectures there, and I'm hoping that one day, God willing, you might be able to come over and see us and visit with us and study with us. We're building research. We're building cabins now. Not cabins, they're more like, what are they, cottages. They're more like Cotswold cottages in our area, so that people can come and study for 3 weeks. Our topic today, as this, we're going to advance the slide, our topic today is one that I have been working with for a while, and text. Now, let me explain what a Yahweh text is. I'm not sure exactly if I'm the one who came up with that, or if I just adopted it from somebody else. As Ecclesiastes said, there's nothing really new under the sun. So a Yahweh text, as I define it, is a quotation of or an allusion to an Old Testament text, which refers directly to and contains the divine name, Yod, He, Vav, He, the ineffable, unspeakable name of God. That's what a Yahweh text is. Now, there are a number of these in the New Testament. My focus has been on the Apostle Paul, because Paul is the earliest writing theologian. We have evidence to what the early Christians were thinking and doing with Scripture and with preaching and teaching and such. Now, since Paul writes his letters in Greek, we don't really have the text, the Yahweh text there, and we have what is really might be a kurios text in Paul's letter, but in those quotations, those kurios texts are referring back to the divine name. Kurios became the surrogate, the name of God in a way. That's why that's what, if you hear dogs barking, by the way, in the back, that's my dogs. I'm at home this morning. But the kurios text that we find in Paul often refer back to and will refer back to in the majority of times the divine name, the Yod, the He, the Vav, the He. Now, we think that name might have been pronounced like Yahweh, but we don't know. That's why I put it in all capitals, YHWH. I'm careful in saying that word. I usually only use it in special occasions like this, when we're referring to something that is sacred and precious to not only the Jewish people, but also Christians as well. Now, one of the questions that you have to deal with along the way is this, and that is, when Paul is writing, what is the state of the text? Would Paul have been familiar with what I'm calling Yahweh text? Would he have been able to locate and see the divine name? Now, Paul describes himself as a Hebrew of the Hebrews. So I'm assuming, right, from that he can read Hebrews. I mean, that's fairly straightforward and not quite self-evident, but you could make that argument because he describes himself in Philippians 3 as a Hebrew of the Hebrews, that he could have read and worked in the Hebrew text. But how would the divine name been represented in these biblical texts, and in some cases non-biblical texts. Well, to look at that, we go back to the papyri, we go back to the Dead Sea Scrolls, for example. And so here's an example of 11Q Psalms text from the Dead Sea Scrolls. And what we find is the tetragram, or the tetragrammaton. That's the long version. And scholars will often use that word tetragrammaton or tetragram to refer to the divine name. So it's not necessarily to speak the name, but because it's four letters, which is what tetragram or tetragrammaton means, the four letters, the four divinely inspired the name of God. And there's a whole history about the name of God that I wish we had time to go into. But here, take a note of this. Now we have, in the Hebrew, we have the text written in an Aramaic, or what's sometimes referred to as a square script. But when it comes to the divine name, the name is written, the divine name, the four letters are written in a Paleo-Hebrew, an ancient Hebrew. It's sort of like in English, if we'd be typing along in our word processor using our Times Roman font, and when we get to God's name, or a word associated with God's name in some cases, we would switch over to a Gothic font. And it would be a bit more elaborate, it'd be a bit larger, it would be a bit more, it would clearly catch your eye. Now we think that the reason that this was done, obviously, is respect for the divine name, but also to alert the reader that when he gets to, probably a he, when he gets to this particular word, you don't say that word. Because saying the name of God in the wrong way, or in the wrong context, or misspeaking God's name was not cool, was not considered right. In fact, according to Mishnah Sanhedrin, I think it's 9:5, somewhere in there, to speak the divine name outside of the most holy context was deemed blasphemy. So you're very careful with the name. And this goes back to one of the top 10 commandments. You do not lift up the name of God, the name of God. And this is the name of God, the Yod, the Hey, the Vav, the Hey, in any silly or useless or vain way. So they in a sense built a fence around it, so that if you never spoke the name of God, if you never uttered the name of God, you certainly could not be guilty of defying that particular and violating that commandment. But this is one example of the kinds of things that was done. Let me move on to another example. And I'm afraid this slide is not very good. I apologize, but let me describe this to you. This is the famous Isaiah scroll, 1Q Isaiah, where the tetragram is written in Aramaic script, the Yod, the Hey, the Vav, the Hey. It's written the same way. But when it comes to the divine name, it's glossed, or written right above it, is the word Adonai. Now, it's hard to see because it's not very clear. And I apologize for that. But this is an example in Isaiah, what we would call in our chapters and verses, Isaiah 65, verse 13. So the tetragram is written in square script, but it's glossed by Adonai. And that is to alert the reader, when you get to that word, you don't say the Yod, the Hey, the Vav, the Hey. You would say Adonai, which was in a sense, a pious surrogate for the divine name. And there's ample evidence, I think, of that at the time. Moving on to another couple of examples here, we see the state of the text here. And I'm afraid that our circle might not be exactly in the right place. But at any rate, this is a document known as Sirach HaYahad, or the Community Rule, or the Manual of Discipline. That's how I first encountered a long time ago, where the divine name is not even written. The divine name is represented by four dots. And Emmanuel Tove referred to this as the terapuncta, as opposed to the tetragrammaton, the tetrapuncta. So the four points that there are represented. And again, that's to alert the reader that when you get here, you don't say the divine name. You're supposed to be schooled enough to know that is representing God's name, and you say Adonai when you come to that point, which is what Jews say today even. Moving on to another example, and we'll move quickly through a few more of these. Here is, again, the four dots. This is a document called 4Q Testimonia. where it gathers together a variety of, as I recall, messianic testimonia. And again, you see the divine name represented here by four dots. Here we see it again in an Isaiah scroll where it is glossed above between the lines, and I think you can see there the tetragram written in four dots. Now there are some places, and I don't have an example of this, where there's just a blank where the divine name was written. And what we think was happening was that a scribe would be writing the text, but he was not allowed to write the divine name. That would be a more senior scholar, more senior scribe, who is supposed to come back in later and write in carefully the divine name. Because once the divine name was written, any part of it, it could not be erased. Other words could be erased, but the divine name was not to be erased. And so you had to be very careful in writing the divine name, however you're going to write it, whether four dots or Paleo Hebrew or Aramaic script. So there are places where the senior scholar never came back and filled in that divine name. So you have a blank there where the divine name is supposed to be. These are just a few more examples. Now here we're moving to Greek text because Paul is writing in Greek. So what's the state of the Greek text at the time? Well, here's an early document from 4Q. It's an LXX or a Greek text of Leviticus where the divine name is actually represented by three Greek letters, Iota, Alpha, Omega, and it would have been pronounced something like Yahoo, Yahoo. And so this is a sort of a surrogate for the divine name. This is a small papyrus, a small manuscript that is written Yahoo for the divine name. It represents probably the sounds, what we might call a transliteration of the divine name. Another example here where we're in a Greek text, the Nahal Hever Minor Prophets text, you're in a Greek text where the divine name is written in Paleo Hebrew. Now, Greek is written the opposite direction, as you know. So when you got to the Hebrew, it would have to be written backwards, right? So it would be like, in a sense, typing along in English, and then all of a sudden a Hebrew word appears in the text. That would be to alert you, again, alert the reader that when you get there, you don't say Yahweh, you say, in a Greek context, you'd say Kurios. Kurios was the word spoken in the synagogues at this time. Don't know the exact date of this text, but it's clearly pre-Christian. Another example or two where we see the devices are early papyrus manuscript, probably 500 AD or 400 to 500 AD, where the divine name is written in a Greek text in Aramaic script. And you'll see that there's space before and space after. This leads us to think again that two different scribes are writing it. One is writing the Greek and the other comes back and fills in the divine name written in Hebrew in an Aramaic, or what is sometimes referred to as a square script. Another example here where the tetragrammaton is written in Paleo Hebrew, an Oxyrhynchus papyri, this is a papyrus manuscript, not a vellum manuscript. I think this is Job 42. That's what we think. It's part of Job 42, but it is fragmentary. So here's the sort of a summary of what we've been looking at in Hebrew text. What is the state of biblical text and other texts that quote biblical text at the time? Because Paul's doesn't think I'm writing a biblical text, but he's writing a text, a letter that is going to contain biblical text. So what's the practice of the time? Well, we have the name, the divine name, written in Aramaic script, which is what you would kind of expect in a lot of manuscripts. You also have the divine name written in a Paleo Hebrew script, again, like English going to Gothic. And then you have the divine name represented, not spoken, obviously, by four dots to alert the reader what they are to do when they get to that. And then finally, the Aramaic script lost by Adonai. Now, I didn't include here the fact that sometimes the divine name is absent from manuscripts that we have. But again, that's one of the things that does happen. It probably was not intentional, but it did happen, and we do have examples of those. Now, what about Greek text? Here's the sort of a summary. In Greek text at the time, we have Yahweh written in Aramaic script. We have Yahweh written in Paleo-Hebrew script. We have Yahweh, and I didn't show you an example of this, but we have Yahweh represented by the four Greek letters, pi, iota, pi, iota. Now, notice how similar that looks to the divine name written in Aramaic script. It would be pronounced, however, pippi, because that's what it would sound like in Greek. So Yahweh here is just represented by that. We hope nobody got to the divine name and said pippi, but it could well be that someone was not schooled and that might have happened. But the Yahweh represented here in four Greek letters. We have Yahweh transliterated as Ya-O, probably as a representative of that. And then we have Yahweh translated or written as Kurios, and we see that in a number of texts as well. I wish we had time to go through. This is actually a fascinating study when you look at all of the examples of how the divine name. Now, just remember, for us, we say divine names all the time. We don't worry too much about it. But the ancients were not so. They had a real respect for and even, I would say, fear of divine names, names of gods, depending upon their context. But in a Hebrew context, they were clearly careful with representing, even writing or speaking, the name of God. Well, our goal here is to look at and to consider Paul. I forgot about this particular slide. P.W. Skian, who was a great papyrologist, came up with a scheme of how this all developed. How do we have so many different conventions? And you might have one convention in one community, another convention in another, yet another. So we don't know the geographic distribution of that. But here's how he said that in the earliest Greek manuscripts that we have, the Tetragrammaton is really transliterated as Ya-O. Could well be. And then later in development, historically, there's an archaizing process that goes into effect. In other words, there is a sense in which people say, we've got to get back to the originals. It's just like the Reformation, if you will, the Reformation impulse, ad fontes, back to the sources. We can't just rely on the Latin. We've got to go to the Hebrew. We've got to go to the Greek. And so there was a greater reliance on the original languages. That could well have happened, and there's some historic possibilities represented there that I think we should consider, where Yahweh is written for a time in Aramaic script, later it was written in Paleo-Hebrew script, and finally, we have the divine name rendered as the word Kurios. And that probably brings us down closer to the time of Jesus, closer to the time of Paul. So when Paul encountered, and I think there's good evidence that when Paul encountered text, he could have encountered Hebrew, he could have encountered Paleo-Hebrew, but also he could have encountered and would have encountered Kurios in his text for and with divine name in Greek-speaking synagogues. And he became more, as it were, because he was apostle to the Gentiles, he became more active and began networking more in those particular communities. So our focus for the rest of the time is going to be, and our time is moving along quickly. Our focus is going to be on those Yahweh texts where God appears as a referent and those Yahweh texts where Christ appears as referent to Kurios, as the divine name, and the divine name is sorted there. Now, for a long time, and when I first encountered these kind of texts, what I heard was this. This was back in the 1980s, by the way, when I was in seminary. It tells you how old I am. That Paul quotes, or Paul uses the word Kurios about 200 times in his undisputed letters, about 200 times. And Kurios is going to refer to Christ in every one of those occasions, except when Paul is quoting the Old Testament. Then all of those must, by necessity, refer to God the Father, wouldn't refer to Jesus. Well, I began looking at that, and I said, well, I don't think that can hold. And that became the kind of focus of my dissertation many years ago under Earl Ellis, who was my doctor father. And he was very efficient and a very great scholar for looking at how Paul was using the Old Testament. That was his first book, Paul's Use of the Old Testament. His PhD was University of Edinburgh back in the late 50s. But he kind of led me in this study, and we began looking at it. And I discovered that Paul was quoting and quoting text. And I realized there's a difference between a quotation, an allusion, and an echo, as Richard Hayes uses it. But I'm looking here specifically at quotations because they, two things. There's a close verbal affinity with a known Septuagintal text, and in some cases a Hebrew text. And also that in some cases, very often, there is a introductory formula. So these are quotations, not allusions. We're going to talk about allusions in just a moment. But I discovered, and when you do a contextual analysis, and that was what was lacking, when scholars just sort of assumed that kurios in a quotation referred to God and not to Christ, they just assume that. When you do a contextual analysis of these texts, it seems clear to me that there are a number of places where Paul takes these divine name texts, these Yahweh texts, and makes Christ the referent, or Christ is, he applies those to Christ, to the work of Christ, to the person of Christ, particularly in the risen and exalted Jesus. So here are the examples. We notice you'll see mostly Romans and 1 Corinthians here, and that's because Paul quotes so much of the scripture in Romans and 1 and 2 Corinthians. And he does so in other letters as well. But when you go to some of the disputed letters, you see fewer quotations. I think if you applied those to the undisputed letters, you'd find a similar pattern along the way. So we have these passages, and I'll let you take note of those and look up those on your own. But I want to go with you and lead you through a couple of discussions here related to particularly the Yahweh text with Christ as referent. And we'll begin with, the allusions. I'm sorry. The allusions. What I noticed, and what I think I've convinced other scholars of, whenever Paul is alluding to a Yahweh text, Christ is always the referent. And there are other examples other than this, but these are three of the key examples. So quotations and allusions. There are quotations where God is the reference. There are quotations where Christ is the referent, but all allusions to a Yahweh text, Christ is the referent in those particular cases. I don't think that's because Paul is looking at those any differently than he is the quotations, by the way. So here we have now a good example. I hope you have Bibles handy. I hope you can read Greek. If you can't, please work on that Greek, get that going, because some of these things are more apparent in the original languages than they are in a good English translation. But we'll begin with Romans 10:13, because it's probably what we call the lowest hanging fruit. It's probably the easiest one to see. And here's the English text. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord, Kuriu, this references back to the divine name, shall be saved. Now, what Paul is doing is he's quoting from Joel 2:32 in the Hebrew Bible, in the LXX, or the Septuagint, that's Joel 3:5. Now, this is an exact quotation, except for Paul has eliminated that first part, and it shall be. And the reason, I think, for him is because the day that Joel was expecting in the future, in this eschatological future, had already come to pass in Paul's day. So he didn't need to say, and it will be, because it was already in his time. It was a part of that already of Paul's eschatology. Already God has done this. So, but otherwise, it's basically word for word. And you'll see that and I've represented it here, Joel, that the divine name, the name of the Lord, calling upon the name of the Lord, which is rendered in the Septuagint as Kuriu, shall be saved. Now, there's a number of good reasons for thinking that what Paul is up to here is he's making this a Christological use of a Yahweh text. Basically, the crystal, and I won't do this with every text, but there is a Christological focus of his discourse. In Romans 9 through 11, the Christological discourse of 9:33 through 10:17 is framed around a theocentric kind of discourse. So you've got a Christocentric discourse in the middle of a theocentric, primarily dialogue that goes on from chapter 9 to verse 11, a very famous part of Romans. But when we get to 9:33 and following, almost all of his references are there to Christ. That's one of the things. There's a resurrection emphasis to this text, and there's a connection in Paul. You can look at my book to see this, and others as well have made note of this, that when Paul thinks of the resurrection, that title Lord often comes to mind. There's an eschatological interest as well. Paul is thinking about what God is up to, what God is doing. Now, eschatology for Paul is not just what is going to be, but eschatology has already happened, because eschatology, the last days have already begun. The new creation has already begun in the resurrection of Jesus. And clearly, and probably the smoking gun here, that may not be a great reference in South Africa, but it is here in North America and the United States. The smoking gun is the Christological confession that Jesus is Lord in 10 verse 9. If you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, then you will be saved, Paul says. And the way that comes down, I've got a couple of Greek texts here, so I'll be looking at it, but in 10:13, it says, Paschar hasan epikalesate ta anima kuriu sothesate. And there's that word Lord, which has already been tied closely to Jesus through this Christological series of verses beginning in 9:33, through the resurrection, through the eschatology of the text, now coming to the confession, Jesus is Lord. So I make the case, and others as well, that have done so, that this clearly is a very important Yahweh text that refers to Jesus as the Kurios, the Lord. And so Jesus there and the divine name are being very closely connected. Now, if you look at 1 Corinthians 1, verse 2, I think it is, Paul refers to the church in Corinth and all Christian churches everywhere as those who call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. He doesn't just say the Lord. He's really alluding to this same text, Joel 2:32. Everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord, but there he adds Jesus Christ to make it clear to everyone. Now, let's see. The next one is a bit more debated. For to this end, this is Romans 14, Christ died and lived again so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Notice the great parallelism between Christ died, lived again, Lord of both the dead and the living. That's going to return in a moment. And so Paul goes on in a series of questions there. He says, why do you pass judgment then on your brother? Why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. And then here's the quotation formula. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow to me and every tongue will give praise to God. So then each of us will be accountable to God. Now, this is a disputed text. I've convinced a number of people, but not everybody, that this is a Yahweh text that refers to Christ. And let me show you how I think this works. But remember this, Christ died and lived again, be Lord of the dead and the living. And then that phrase, that oath formula, as I live, says the Lord. Okay, that's going to become important for our discussion in a moment. Now, here are the two texts. Paul's text, as I live, says the Lord, to me, will bow every knee and every tongue will confess to God. That's probably my translation. It's fairly literal. But this comes from Isaiah 45:23. By myself I swear. And then there's another couple of lines then, that to me will bow every knee and will confess every tongue to God. Now notice that in Isaiah, the oath formula is by myself I swear. And when Paul quotes it, he quotes it, as I live, says the Lord. Okay, keep that in mind for just a moment. Now, Paul has exchanged one oath formula for another. If you go back to Isaiah, there are other places in Isaiah, I think chapter 44, where that oath formula as I live, says the Lord, is present. So it's not as if it's not present, and it's a very common oath formula in the Hebrew Bible. But Paul has exchanged one for the other, I think, to make what is amounts to a Christological point. Now, let me go back a slide, and you'll see what I'm talking about here. For to this end, Christ died and lived again. Notice that phrase, lived again. That is the only place in Paul's letters where he refers to the resurrection as lived again. Now, why does he do that? Because he's trying to tie that into the argument both of the Lord of the living, of the dead and the living. And I think trying to tie it in, as I live, says the Lord. Lived again, lived. I think that's what Paul is going to. Now let's go to the sort of the payoff. What's the payoff for that, and how does that work? I think this is the way the text should be read. Accordingly, as I live again by the resurrection, says the Lord Jesus, every knee will bow to me and every tongue will confess to God. And this is at the judgment seat, because he refers to that at the next moment. So what Paul has done, he's taken that one text and he's parsed it out to God, to me, the Lord Jesus, or, you know, to, as he's speaking, the Lord Jesus, and then God. Now, Paul does the same thing in 1 Corinthians 8, 6, but he reverses it. He says, as for us Christians, there is one God, the Father, from whom are all things, and for whom we exist. And there's another, the other Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we exist and through whom we have been made and through whom we exist. So what Paul has done is he's taken the Shema. Again, he's sort of made what Larry Hurtado calls a binitarian formula out of it. And I think that's what he's doing here as well. So I argue that this is a Yahweh text where Paul takes Isaiah 45:23 and again makes that a Christological reference. One more example very quickly from an allusion, because it uses the same text. Therefore, and we've got to move through this. This is a wonderful text. The second part of what's called the Philippian hymn or the Christ hymn. Therefore, God has highly exalted him, given him the name that is above every name. What name could that be except probably the divine name? So at the name of Jesus, not the name Jesus, but probably the name that belongs to Jesus. And what name is that? The name which is above every name. Every knee will bow of those from heaven and on earth and under the earth. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, or Jesus the Messiah, I think that's better, is Lord. Ultimately to the glory of God the Father. This does not distract in one way. This is not blasphemous. This does not distract in one way from God's glory. In fact, God gets glory when every knee bows, every tongue confesses. Now there's this text. This is not a quotation, but it's taking the language of Isaiah 45:23, which is the most stridently monotheistic text in the Hebrew Bible. You find monotheism, and I'll define that later. Maybe that's a tough word to define in the ancient context, but when you find that, it's just enthusiastically endorsed in Isaiah 45:23. Now, we don't have time to go through too many of these, because I want to get to some of the discussion. And here's an example. Thus says the Lord, Yahweh Kurios, who created the heavens, formed the earth, didn't create it from chaos, formed it to be inhabited, which is a reflection on Genesis 1. I am the Lord, Yahweh Kurios, there is no other. And another example, saying, declare, present your case, let them hold their counsel together. Who told this long ago? Who declared it of old? Was it not I, the Lord, Yahweh, Kurios? There's no God beside me, a righteous God and Savior. There is no God beside me. And here, finally, I think in this scheme here, we come down to the text that was quoted in both Romans 14:11 and then alluded to in Philippians 2, Isaiah 45, turn to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God, Elohim, and there is no other. By myself I have sworn, there's that oath formula, from my mouth has gone forth in righteousness, a word that shall not return to me, every knee will bow, every tongue shall swear. Now, that particular, that's the Hebrew term. We find it translated a little bit differently as homologein is the word group, as I recall there. So, very important text, stridently monotheistic, and yet now Jesus is somehow being included within that by having and bearing the divine name and being included in the work of God in such an elegant way. Larry Kreitzer, in his book Jesus and God in the Eschatology of Paul, said it's difficult to imagine any first century Jew or Christian roughly, remotely familiar with Isaiah 45, hearing this final stanza of Philippians 2 without recognizing the words of theistic import, grand theistic import, have now been applied to Christ, which is a Christological move, eschatological, it's exegetical move, not eschatological, exegetical move that is astounding when you think about it, happening so early after the execution of Jesus in what is Roman controlled Jerusalem. Just a few things. This Christological binitarian monotheism is the title here. But one of the big questions has been how did this happen? How did this begin to roll out? How did early Christians who were Jews begin and who were monotheists begin to think of Christ? And there are a number of different answers to that. I wish we had time to go into that more fully, but we don't. Let me just go through a couple of things. But this, if Christ has been included within the name and the dignity and God, what later becomes in the church language, the person of God, it can account for a number of other things. The worship of Christ, the words of Christ having such exalted status right there aside scripture. And seeing him as pre-existent, the agent of creation, the coming judge, and such. It can help explain a number of things there. Larry Hurtado was a good friend of mine. He passed away November 25th last year. He was my mentor, and I followed Larry for a number of years. We have disagreed over a number of these texts that we've argued about, but by and large, I think I convinced him and a number of others. How did this happen? How did the Jews who are monotheists come to include Jesus in this such a close association with God that these divine name texts, the text containing the divine name, could be so closely associated with Jesus so that Jesus as the Lord could be seen? Well, Larry could be seen in this light. Then Larry's great work on One God, One Lord, and later Lord Jesus Christ enters that through the divine agency concept. But it was not just divine agency in Judaism, principal angels, exalted patriarchs. For him, all of this has been spawned, or the catalyst for all this were powerful religious experiences with the risen Christ. And that helped to reshape monotheism at the time and the practices, the worship, particularly the worship practices of the early Christian communities. Let me move on to Richard Baucom, a friend of mine who's written a delightful fellow, wrote a number of books and has made the case, and I love this language, I use it, I adopt it. The early Christians, like Paul, and even before Paul, included Jesus precisely and unambiguously within the unique identity of the one God of Israel. Great statement. Again, it's one that, if you ponder it, will be very helpful. Now, what Baucom said is that divine agency, Hurtado's divine agency, wasn't sufficient. And we need to reconceptualize this in terms of identity. Not so much persona, person of later years, but of divine identity. And what he said basically is this, that there are in the universe two things exist. There's God and everything that's not God. So where are we going to put Jesus? Are we going to put Jesus on this side, everything that's not God? Or are we going to put Jesus on this side, everything that is God? What side of the ledger do we put it on? And Baucom said that we've got to reconceptualize or think about divine identity, and that Jesus is included in that divine identity. That accounts for the state, this particular state of things. These are complex arguments, by the way. I'm just trying to summarize for you. More recently, the work of N.T. Wright. You might know his work, this two big volume, Paul and the Faithfulness of God, and he makes a great deal about Jews at the time of Jesus and of Paul thinking themselves still in a state of exile. And what he says is that central to Second Temple Judaism is the conviction that at the time of the Babylonian conquest, 586 BC, that Jews believed that God had abandoned them. He had abandoned the temple, and he had promised that he would come again, and he would one day restore his people. He would one day restore Jerusalem. He would one day restore the temple to its greater glory, and that return, God Yahweh himself would return to Zion. In this Zion return to Zion sort of theory that he develops is the way to account for early Christology, so that in Yahweh's return to Zion would be a personal return, come in person, and that he would come in glory. And that glory would be to for the purpose of judging and saving and ultimately redemption. So he says that this return to Yahweh, excuse me, return of Yahweh to Zion or to Jerusalem can account for all these Christological developments because Jesus is the embodiment of Yahweh. Jesus is seen to be the person of Yahweh having returned. Well, let's see if I can, hopefully we go to the next slide. Very quickly, a little book that I found published in the 1940s, A.R. Johnson, The One and the Many in the Israelite Conception of God. A lot of people don't know about this, but it's a great book. And you'll notice from the very title, it sort of gives you a hint that within a monotheistic framework of one God, that the Israelites envision God as having a number of manifestations, including spirit, word, wisdom, name, and others, and that this provided kind of the space, exegetical space, for Jesus to be included in the divine name, in the divine identity, and to be seen as the embodiment of the one God of Israel. Richard Hayes as well brings this. So here's my conclusion. The kurios title for Paul, in all of its occurrences, but particularly in those Yahweh texts, provided him with the language that he needed and particular sets of associations that he needed in order to make very bold claims about the risen Jesus and how significant he was for these new people of God. In particular, his use of Yahweh texts is just this astounding exegetical appropriation of scripture language to express his devotion to Christ. And I don't think we should underestimate that language. The claim that Paul makes about Christ is audacious. I think that's the reason Paul became a persecutor of the church in the first place, because these first Christians that he encountered were making these audacious and blasphemous claims from his point of view. And the link that Paul makes, if it were a fiction, would be scandalous and was deemed to be scandalous. But if it's true, then it says a great deal not only about God, but it says a great deal about Christ, so that we as Christians cannot think about God without thinking about Christ. Thanks for your time and interest. I know I've gone a little bit further in time than I meant to, but I appreciate your listening.